Hello everybody, welcome to my webinar about numeric calculations in DAX. So this is a slight introduction to dynamic analysis expressions. My name is Markus Ehrenmüller-Jensen and yeah, welcome and thanks for joining the webinar or watching the recording. So DAX, the data analysis expression, sometimes I wrote data analytic expression. I'm not sure when I got confused about the naming, but there was Wahid a couple of hours contacted me via LinkedIn and pointed out that there was a typo in my slide and in the first slide. So I changed it to data analysis expressions. That's the official name of DAX. So DAX was born with Power Pivot for Excel. I'm not sure who of you has worked with Power Pivot for Excel. This was an add-in or still an add-in available for Excel. And as this was the first version of what we now know as Power BI or as SQL Server Analysis Services Tabular, the language is used for meshes and calculated columns. And it's like similar to what we're used to from Excel. So the syntax is actually derived from Excel. About 80 functions are identically in Excel formula language and in DAX. Excel formula language is function based, so you call a function parentheses and then you put in the parameters, and another function could be also in parameters, so you can like have several functions calling each other. But the thing with DAX is that the syntax is really easy to learn. That's something you will really fast check out, but the semantic is very complex. And this is a good thing because it allows for powerful computations, but it's a bad thing because it takes some time to really understand what's going up there. So for this talk, I chose three calculations and I want to make sure that everybody understands the calculations because I want to concentrate then on DAX and not on the calculation. The first calculation I will use is sales amount. And if we have the price and the quantity given, we calculate the sales amount as price times quantity. The next calculation we will do is the margin. The margin is that what we get from the sales amount if we subtract the total cost. So sales amount minus the total cost gives us the margin. And the third one we're talking about is the margin in percentage. That's the margin percentage of the sales amount. So it's the margin divided by the sales amount. And then you can multiply it with 100 to get a percentage or use the modeling tab in Power BI to make a percentage out of that. So please be sure that you understand those calculations because I want to concentrate on the DAX and not on the calculations. If you're watching this like a recording, please make a hard copy, a screenshot of this so you have it at hand when we talk about the actual calculations then in DAX. I want to start with the calculated columns because I think they're the most easy to understand because they look like or they perform like a calculation in Excel. We have like cells and then we copy and paste the same formula to the cells and then this calculation is repeated for all my columns or for all my rows. So when we use refer to calculated columns, we should use this syntax that we always state the table name and then the column name. For measures, we will omit the table name, as we will see in a few minutes, because it's really important when we refer to those objects that we are pretty sure, is it a column or is it a measure? So for columns, we always write the table name. That's not a syntactical thing, but it makes it easier to understand what's happening in the calculation. And despite that it's named calculated column, it's calculated row by row. So the formula is put for one column and this formula is then repeated for all the rows within the table where we put the calculated column in. The result of the calculated column is also persisted in the model. So if I write this calculation, then we get another column there and this column will take up space in the model. So the Power BI file will get bigger. And every time we refresh the model, so we press refresh the refresh button, then all the data is loaded, and after the data is loaded, then the calculated columns are recalculated and again persisted, stored in our Power BI file. The data type is automatically determined by the formula, and we can change it, of course. And in this 60 minutes, we will concentrate on numeric calculated columns. I will not talk about fancy text functionalities or time intelligence stuff, just simple calculated columns. And the aim is that we really understand what's happening in the calculated column. There's one speciality with the calculated columns. If you connect to like a tabular model or to Power BI via Excel, this is possible. Check out, there's a lot of stuff out in the internet which will explain you how you can connect an Excel spreadsheet to an open Power BI file. And if you do this, you will find out that if there's a calculated column, even if it's a numeric calculated column, you can put it in the filter columns and rows, but you cannot put it in the values. This is just not allowed. Power BI allows us to create pivot tables or tables and matrices and put the calculated column in there, because behind the scenes, it's creating an implicit measure. And this is a good thing, because then we can put stuff where we want to put it, like the calculated column, into the values region of a table. But it's hard to explain because it's not visible. We cannot see this measure anywhere, so it's hard for me to explain it to you where it is and that it is there. So just trust me, it is there. But it can be the source of some confusion, because we only created a column and suddenly behind the scenes there's also a measure available. How is this measure calculated? It's a very simple aggregation, like a sum or min or whatever, and we control this by the column property default summation. So the default summation is in the modeling part of Power BI, and there you have the free choice of sum, average, minimum, maximum, count, or count distinct, and you can also choose to not summarize the thing. Then no implicit measure is created for you. And this is not only possible to select and change in the modeling tab for the calculated column for the whole of your model, you can also change it per visual. So in every visual, you also have the possibility to change it to some average, minimum, maximum. Funny enough, like the UI have the count distinct here, and in the modeling it's down there, so they exchange it here. And we have three more possibilities if you're changing the summation for a field in a visual, which can also be standard deviation, variance, and median. What Power BI does is it checks out this summation and then creates an implicit measure which is hidden. We can't see it, which takes just the expression of the column, put it in parentheses, and then put, for example, a sum or average or a min or a max before it. That's how it is created. So let's start with our first calculated column. Very simple, sales amount. I hope you remember those three formulas. The sales amount is calculated, if you have the price and the quantity given, by multiplying the price with the sales quantity. And if we do this, then, for example, for the sample table, really, really easy sample, that's four lines, four entries in this table, and we have the price of 10 and the quantity of 3, and this gives us 30 for the sales amount. 20 times 1 is 20, 30 times 4 is 120, 100 times 5 is 500. And then we also have this total, 670. And the question is, how is this calculated? This is calculated by the implicit measure. If the implicit measure or the default summation for our sales amount says sum, then this implicit measure will sum up those results. So 30 plus 20 plus 120 plus 500 gives us 670. And we also can see this in a live example. So I've like copy and pasted the formula here so we can easily read it. Then we have this table here, 10 times 3 is 30. And so on. So we can see the calculation is done right. And if we only put the sales amount into a table by date, then the summation, the default summation, does not only work for the total, but also sums up like two rows. We have two rows with the same date, 1st of October. We have only one row 1st of October here, because Power BI automatically groups the data and it's summing up the 30 and the 20 and gives us 50 here, and we still have the 670 here. So this is working really easy. As I told you, DAX, to understand DAX is really, really easy to read. So sales margin, the next easy one, sales amount margin, we do not multiply, but we subtract the total cost from the sales amount. And if I give you another, the more or less the same example, a few euros, we have sales amount of 50 and the total cost of 40 gives us a margin of 10. 120 minus 75 gives us 45, 500 minus 350, 150. And then for the total 205, again, the implicit measure comes into place as the default summation is sum. We get 10 plus 45 plus 150 equals 205. And this is not only on the slides, but we can see this in the demo as well. So we have the margin here, 20 minus 15 is 5, and so on and so forth. And then we have the 205 here for the total of the table for the margin column. Easy as that. So let's have the third example, the margin in percentage. So the margin in percentage is the margin divided by the sales amount in the same table again. So if we take a look on our sample table, we have four rows again. So 5 divided by 20 is 25%, 5 divided by 30 is 16, 45 divided by 120 is 37, 150 divided by 500 is 30. So we have between 16% and 30% margin. That means if we sell a good of the price of 100, then for example 30 euros or 30 whatever stays at us. So that's the margin in percent of 30% here. But then we have this 109 here. So 109 is a margin in percentage is just not possible. We cannot have a bigger margin than the sales amount, because like, you give me 100 euros and then I have to pay like 70 for the goods I deliver to you, and 30 is my margin then. But if you give me 100 euros, there's no way that 109 euros could stay at me. So that's not, it's not possible to have a margin bigger than 100%. So why is this? Because we have this implicit measure. And the implicit measure currently says sum. So 25 plus 16 plus 37 plus 30 gives us this 109. And of course, this is rubbish. This is wrong. This calculation does not really work. If you see this in our example, sales in a sales percent, say margin in percent, then we have like the calculations again here. But as soon as something summed up, like the 1st of October, two entries here, this is not really working out. Maybe it's correct, maybe not, but it's, I changed my thing here. So my bad. This should like, the default should be the sum here. Then we see like the 25 plus the 16 is summed up to 41, and this is wrong, and we see the 109 here. So one way to fix it, this is not really to fix it, this is only to hide that we have a problem, is to change the default summation from sum to average. That's some people suggesting this. And then we get like, decent numbers, could be right or could not be right. The question is, is it okay to have an calculate the average here, or what is the right sum? So the right value for the average of margin for total would be the sum of the margins divided by the sum of the sales amount. So this would be, can we calculate this? If I calculate this live here, 5 plus 5 plus 45 plus 150 gives us 205. And then we have 20 plus 30 plus 120 plus 500, 670. And this 670 we divide by the 205 by the 205 by the 607. 105 divided by 670. So the correct number would be 30% or 30.5%. What we get with the average is 27. So some would say this is close enough, but I don't think this is right, because it depends on the actual numbers if this is more close or not close. And anyway, it's wrong. We should not calculate it this way. And I don't see any solution in calculated columns here. So let's move on to measures. So what's a measure? What is a measure different from a calculated column? First, a convention, if we refer a measure, we should omit the table name for it. So we can really see in the formula that now we are referring to a measure. As I promised, we'll see this later throughout the 60 minutes, why the reason why I suggest this, and many people suggest this. And I think of a measure like this is an element or a formula which is detached from any table. So the calculated column lives in the table and is calculated row by row. The measure looks at the whole model, at all the tables, like from an outside perspective. This is how I imagine being a measure is. So there's no row context, there's only a filter context, because of course, if I see the table, I might never see like the unfiltered table. The table is always filtered, like we have slicers or we have cross filters between the visuals. There would be a page or report filter. And of course, in the pivot table, we have rows and columns, and those are filtering the measure. So there's just one formula. But depending on the context where I put it, like inside of a pivot table with different filters on columns and rows, the same formula will come back with different results. This is because the model always looks different for every position where the measure is. The calculation is definitely not done row by row, because there is no concept for row, no row context in the measure, except we will see later that we can force to do so. And what's also really important as a differentiation is that the measure, the result of a measure is not saved in the model. So if we build a lot of measures, the model, the size of the Power BI file will not increase. It will stay the same more or less. I mean, it's a couple of characters for the formula, which of course are stored in the model, but there's no space used for the results. And also the refreshing of the Power BI file is not influenced by measures, so the refresh will not calculate any measures, the refresh will not be slower, the file will not grow. And the measures behave the same if I connect to the model with Excel or Power BI. So Excel allows me to put measures into the value part portion of a pivot table. So let's take a look on the margin percentage, which was calculated wrong as a calculated column. So what do we have here? Margin percentage is the sales margin divided by sales amount. But as I told you, a measure does not have any row context. So it sees the full table or the filter table, the sales table. So there could be potentially not only one row, but many rows of the sales table looks from the outside onto the model. So we always have to state how those potentially many rows are aggregated. So in this case, I sum it up. So I ask DAX to calculate the sum of margin and divide it by the sum of sales amount. So when we look at this example, we have one row here, a margin of 10, amount sales amount of 50. So 10 divided by 50 is 20%. 45 divided by 120 is 37.5%, and 150 divided by 500, 30%. And then we get the 30.6%, because the measure never calculates it like in a downwards portion, but now it takes the sum of the margin, so the total of the margin and the total of the sales amount, and then divide it each other. So 205 divided by 670, as I just performed in the calculator, ends up as 30.6. So this is working fine. If we go into our demonstration here, so the margin in percentage as a measure, so I take this in blue so everybody can see it. It's a measure, and I omitted the table up there, so everybody can see this is a measure. So this measure is now working in all circumstances, because it's summing up the elements, and that's the right way of calculating a percentage. So we can, I never saw a correct calculation of calculating percentages and then summing them up or averaging them up. This is most probably a wrong way. We always have to sum up first the elements, like the margin and the sales amount, and then perform the division. So what about the margin? Can we calculate the margin also in a measure instead of a calculated column? Yes, we can. Again, we have to put some aggregation there because the measure sees the filtered table, sales table, and this can consist of many rows. And then we have the sum of sales amount minus the sum of total cost. So we have 50 minus 40 is 10, 120 minus 75 is 45, 500 minus 350 is 150. And then again, the measure never calculates downwards, but always calculates horizontally. So 670 minus 565 equals 205. And this also can lead to some confusion because people tend to like calculate the total in downwards process. So I've seen reports where people complain that the sum is not correct because it's not correct in the way I cannot calculate like that. Then we have to find another trick, which we'll see in a minute. And this is this one, sales amount. So the sales amount is the price times the quantity. Again, we had to put sum on it. We cannot write a measure and referring columns without stating aggregate functions. It's just not possible. So if you have the first example here, 30 times 4, 120 looks okay. 30 times 4, 120 again, 100 times 5, 500. But then we have this 2080. So we sold 120, 120, 500. If this is correct, it's not. But even if this is correct, we should have like 740, but not 2000. Why do we have 2080? Because measure is not calculated in a downwards motion, but calculated horizontally. So 160 times 13 equals 2080. I mean, this is correct from the technical perspective. 160 times 13 is 2080, but this is not what we expect for the sales amount, because what we need is a sum of the sales amount, the sum of the multiplications, not the multiplications of the sum. So this, like, the operators are not in the correct way here. And this we can also see here, the margin. We've not seen the margin, but the sales amount wrong, calculated wrong, gives us these numbers, because it's not calculated in this way, but it's calculated by the sum. And I mean, if you think about it, the sum of a price doesn't give any meaning. I mean, it doesn't make any sense to sum up a price. We could take an average, but again, this would be then close, but not the correct calculation. So this is wrong. Don't do this. So how can we, now we have the problem. We solved some things with the calculated column, and we solved other things with the measures. So is this the way to distinguish when should I use calculated columns and when should I use measures? No. We can, of course, solve this with the measure. So what we need is that we have this sales table, like these rows. What we need is that we need to take the calculation price times quantity per every row in the sales table. So for all the rows here, we have to calculate price times quantity. So we get like 10 times 3 is 30, 20 times 1 is 20, 30 times 4, 120, and then 500. But then we don't need a calculation like the sum of the price times the sum of the quantity, but now we need this in a downwards projection, a downwards calculation. And we can force this by stating sum x. So sum x, it's like the sum function. It's summing up the results of this calculation. So sum x has two parameters. First is the table, which delivers the row context. So we're calculating something row by row for the sales table in this case. And we state here that we calculate the price times the quantity for all the rows in this table. But at the end, if we have aggregated values, we do not calculated with the aggregate values, but we just aggregate the single values. What we have seen with the calculated column and the implicit measure. This is what we can do with this aggregator function. So x stands for aggregator. I'm not sure where this x is coming from or why is this x or not a for aggregator. And this function is not only available for sum, also it is also available for an average or average x, min x, max x. There's some more I can't remember currently. So this is how we get the correct calculation in this sales amount. So we have like on single rows in the table, this is calculated row per row. So we deliver a row context now to the measure. But as soon as this is done for all the rows, which are visible in the visible in the current filter context, yes, as soon as this is done, then it's aggregated with a sum x. So let's rethink what we have seen. So we have seen the sales amount, and we have seen two versions of calculated sales amount. One was the sum of the calculations price times quantity, and the other one was sum price times the sum of the quantity. The question is, are both correct? Is only one correct? Which one is correct? And hopefully you remember this, right? So we can only calculate the price times the quantity and then sum the results up. It's not possible to sum up the price and sum up the quantity and then multiply. This will not lead to the correct sales amount. We can calculate the first one in measures, as we have seen with the sum x functionality function. And we, of course, can calculate this in the calculated columns. The second one is only possible in a measure, but we should not do that. So now it's 1-1 for measures and calculated columns. The margin. Can the margin be calculated as the sum over the difference of sales amount and total cost? And or can it calculate it as the sum of sales amount minus the sum of total cost? So the difference of the sums. And this is possible in both ways. And we can calculate the first one as measure and calculate the column, and the second one is only possible in measures. So there we have the free choice of what to use or how to calculate it. The margin in percentage. Can we calculate the margin in percentage as the sum of the margin divided by the sum of sales amount? And or can we calculate it as the sum of margin divided by sales amount? So we're summing up the results of the division. And the second one again is wrong. The first one can be calculated as a measure. The second one could be calculated as a measure or calculated column. So far we can calculate everything with a measure, and sometimes we have problems with a calculated column. This leads me to the first takeaways. We are not finished with this talk, but I want to like have a little break in between. Think about what we have seen. So the takeaway is that we should always take care about our numeric columns and think about the default summation. So remove the default summation for columns which should not be calculated. So the which should not be like aggregated. Typically the price, as we have seen, or for the date dimension, the calendar year and the month number. If you take the calendar year and just drag it into the report pane of report canvas of Power BI, and you do not see a list of years, but you get like 3 trillions, then probably your default summation is set wrong for the calendar year. It should be set to not summarize. For all the other columns where we need the aggregation, please create a measure for those with the correct aggregation, of course. It could be multiple, so like you have two or three or four measures for one calculated column showing the sum or the average or the smallest or the biggest value, and then hide the original column so nobody uses the original column, because then we always have this default summation, and then sometimes the calculation could be wrong. And my recommendation is to not to create calculated columns at all. This is really harsh, but I think this is right. As I stated here, don't create numeric calculated columns at all. If you need them, if you need columns, and there are certain situations where you need a column, for example, if you want to filter, you cannot filter on a measure, then you have to have a column, or some visuals ask you for calculated columns and do not allow you to use measures in them. Then, of course, you have to create the calculation as a column. But please don't do it in DAX in the model, but use Power Query, which comes with another language, unfortunately. So you have to learn another language, M, to calculate stuff there in Power Query, or even better, as early as possible, like in the data source. So somebody who delivers you a CSV or Excel file, It should be calculated there, or if you are lucky and can connect to a data warehouse or to a cube or tabular database, then they should make sure to calculate it there, because there's a high probability that you're not the only one who needs the calculation. And if you do it in your Power BI file in DAX or in M, that's only available for you, and all the others have to replicate the formula. So it's better to have it in the data source. That's the one reason. And why you should put it into Power Query and not as into DAX, into the model, is that because if you put it in Power Query, there's a higher potential that the compression algorithm will be better. So your Power BI file will be smaller, and the smaller the file is, you should expect then that the performance of the queries and the performance of the reports are better. So let's proceed to the next level in numeric calculations in DAX. So what I want to look on is, can we use an iterator like SumX, which we just used in a measure, to get a grow context into a measure? Can we do this in a calculated column? What if you're using a measure inside a calculated column? Is this possible? Let's take a look. So we have the sales amount here again, the sales amount, and I calculated this with SumX instead of sum. So previously, not instead of sum. Previously, we only had sales price times sales quantity. And now I put into a calculated column the iterator function sumX to iterate over the sales table. That's the table where we have the price and quantity in it, and then calculate the price and times the quantity. So the question is, what will be the outcome? Would be this like the sales amount we would expect for every row? We get the sales amount for this row, or what would be the outcome? So think a little about that. And if you watch the recording, just pause the recording and think about it before you start pressing play again. So if we have this sales amount sum X, then we get the result of 670, because sum X is calculated. So like the calculated column is executed for all the rows. So for the first row, it takes, of course, 10 times 3, but it then continues, because for the first row, it will then iterate over the whole table. So for all the rows, it will iterate over the whole table. And as we can remember, the sum of the sales amount for the whole table is 670, because for the first row, it will take like 10 times 3. Then it will also calculate it 10 times 1, 30 times 4, 100 times 5. And then it's like the execution of this expression. And then the sum X will make sure that all those values, those four values, are summed up. The iterator sums up to 670. And this is done for all the rows. The next row, it also iterating over the whole table. For the third row, it will iterating over the whole table. And the fourth row, it will do the same. So for all the rows, it's iterating over the whole table. So we get the 670. This can be a good thing. Maybe you need this in one column, but probably not, because we use calculated columns to filter on it, but the filter would be the very same for all the columns. And if this comes to the surprise to you, that like we get 670 at all the rows, then it's because you were not aware that the calculated column has a row context. But this row context, so the row context is like I'm sitting in this row. This row context does not filter the sales table, which is used in the SumX. So the row context is not transferred into a filtering or transitioned into a filtering of the sales table. So for this row, the sales table looks like all the rows of the sales table. And that's why we get the 670 on all the rows as the result. Also see this in the demo file. I think this is this one where we see SumX. Here we go. So we get the sum X of sales price times quantity, and then we get the 670 on all the rows. And of course, the total will be not very useful, I guess, because it's summing up 670 four times, because there's this default summation in the sales amount column, and this is set to sum. One way would like to click it and to ask it not to summarize, then we at least get rid of this wrong summation here. Next question is if we're referring from one column and another column. So this is a really simple formula. I have this sales amount C for column, and then I just put in here the name of another column of the sales amount calculation. What will be the result? I think the result is no surprise to anybody. It just copies the value. So 20 is copied over and all the values are copied over. So of course this is working out. We can refer one column in another column and it's not showing the sales amount, the total of the whole table. But as we're just referring another column, the row context is coming in. So for this value, the row context makes sure that I only see this sales amount. So sales amount C only sees one row of sales amount, which is 20. We again can see this here. So we have like just copied the value, the original formula over. Because when one column is referring to the other one, then this row by row context is done, or the calculation is done row by row, and therefore the new calculated column only has the value of the old column. What if we have a measure inside the calculation of a calculated column? So sales amount M has a very simple formula, sales amount. And sales amount, I just omitted the table name, so this should give you a hint. This is not the column sales amount, but this is the measure sales amount. And the question here, and again, if you're watching the recording, you can pause this at this moment. The question here is, does this work? Do we get an error? Or if we don't get an error, what will be the result? Just to remind you, for the sales amount measure, we use the sum X formula. So sum X over sales price times sales quantity. When we use this formula sum X inside a calculated column, what happened? We got the total of the sales table. So this was this one. When we had the sum X here, we got the 670 here. So when we have the sum X in the calculated column, we got 670. So one way to what we could expect is that we get the 670 also here because we have the sum X here. Funny enough, we get the right values. So for this sales amount M, which is referring the measure, we get the right values, 30, 20, 120, 500, not 670 at all the places. Why is this so? Because if we have a row context, and in this row context, we have a measure, then DAX transitions the row context into a filter context. So we have a measure inside of a row context in this table, and this row context is then transitioned that for the sake of the calculation here, the sales table is only one row. So when this is calculated for the first row, the sales table is only consisting of this one row. This only happens if you're using a measure inside a calculation where a row context is. So if we use a measure inside of a calculated column, the calculated column is inside of a row context, then for the sake of the measure, the row context is transitioned into a filter context. And this can be a surprise. And this is the reason why it's really important that we see in the formula if we're referring a measure or if we're referring a calculated a column. Because for a column, this filter transition is not done. For a measure, it is done. And this is a very important difference. And therefore, it's really important that we know when we have a column or when we have a measure at hand inside of a formula. So let this sink. If we go back here, we can see this is also working in the demo here. So I have this sales amount M, calculated column, sales amount M, and this consists of the sales amount measure. So sales amount measure has this iterator to calculate the price times the quantity for all the rows available in the current filter context, and then summing up. And as this measure is used inside a calculated column, And for meshes, we have this rule that the row context is transferred into filter context. For the sake of this row, of this one element, the filter context from this row is row context of this row is transitioned into a filter context for this measure, and so this measure sees only one row, 10 and 3, and this is what we get here, 30. For this row, the filter context for the measure is again only 20 and 1, 20, and so on and so forth. And what we can do is we can also use or simulate this effect of transition a row context into a filter context by making the following. So I again have a sales amount, a calculated column. I use the sum x, sales price times quantity. So the same formula we have seen now in the measure, then inside of the calculated column, and then in the measure inside of the calculated column. Now I put this little formula inside calculate. So calculate is another function available in DAX. And when I first have seen calculate, I thought, name, I know English. I mean, calculate means to calculate something. What could be the danger, or what could be the special thing with calculate? And this was a big mistake. So don't be me when learning DAX. Don't assume that you know what a function does because you know English. You assume what the name stands for. Calculate especially is a very complex function. It can be very cool things, but we have to be aware of what it does. And calculate does the following. It transitions the row context into a filter context. So we don't need a measure. So we don't need to put the measure, the sum x into the measure. We can also use calculate of sum x of sales price times quantity inside of a calculated column, and then we will get the right result, like the calculation is done only row by row, the right values are showing up. Because calculating, this is one of different functionalities calculate does and performs for us, is transition the row context into a filter context. This is what we see here, the sales amount calculation. So we have this calculate of sum x over the sales table, price times quantity, and again we see the right values, the calculation, the sales amount for each row, which we would expect, and also the total is working up because this can be summed up then with the default summation again. So the second takeaway from this talk before we come into the real hard stuff is that calculated columns can reference other columns, and this is then done row by row. So one column is referring another column. Of course, I only see the value of the column for the current row. But this row context does not filter here. But there's a question, Deepak.
Yes, Marcus, I was about to interrupt you. So does the DAX allows a parameter to be passed in for a calculation?
Does DAX allow to put a parameter in for the calculation? I don't really. Can the person elaborate more in more detail what he or she means?
Yeah, it's from an anonymous person. So yeah, we need to wait for it because it's been a single sentence question, like, does the DAX allow a parameter to be passed in for a calculation? All right, so.
I only have these formulas and this. And I can refer to the formula under this name. This could be a calculated column or a measure, but there's no way that I have a parameter like here, which then puts into the calculation. If this is meant, no, this is not possible. But I'm not really sure if I understood the question correctly. So the person may reach out to me at the very last slide. There's my email address and my Twitter handle. Just reach out to me and I will make sure that you get the right answer.
Okay. So anyway, I've replied back saying that, can you briefly brief the question furthermore? So let's wait for that.
Yeah, thank you very much. So again here, takeaways. The row context does not filter the table. That's what we have seen when we used the sum x within a calculated column, because sum x has this first parameter, a table, and this table is not filtered by the current row. So this is not applied. If we want the filter transitions from the row context to the filter context, we can use calculate, or we can put the measure, the calculation deform, the formula into a measure, and the measure also, for the measure also this transition is happening because, again, implicitly DAX wraps calculate around the measure. We don't see this. Again, this is very nice that DAX is doing this for us, but if you're not aware of that, we are confused that the same formula put directly in the calculated column behaves differently as if we do put the very same formula in the measure and then using the measure in the calculated column. This can be confusing, but it's the way it is. And the reason is because there's around the measure, there's automatically put a calculate around it. And now we're coming back to why best practice is to always put the table name in front of the column and omit the table name in the measure, is because it's really important that we see in the formula, is this element referred in the formula, is this a column or is this a measure? And another thing is, so one thing is like here that the context transition is happening for the measure. And the other thing is that, as I mentioned, a measure does like live detached of any table. So like it looks at the whole model, but it's not really part of a table calculation wise. Of course, we have to put a measure into a table because otherwise we cannot refer it. So we need the measures to be part of one of the tables here, because it has to show up somewhere in the field list, and the field list is always first the table and then the field. But what I do since a year now, maybe I put all the measures into a separated measure table. So it also makes clear it's not part of any of the other tables here. And of course we could move it around. So I can move the margin again back to the sales table, because people expect that the calculation for the margin is in the sales folder here in the field list. Then I can do this, but only if I never used the table name to refer to measures. Because if I have in formulas, I refer to measures with like underscore measure and then the measure name, and then I move the measure from here to another table, then of course I break my formulas. So this is the second reason why you should not refer to measures with the table in before. So let's bring it to the third and last level. We can calculate the filter context, we can manipulate the filter context with calculate. We've just seen this and we can play around with this. So I have a measure which has the name product A, and this measure shows me the sales amount, and this is wrapped into calculate. If we use this, we get, of course, a syntax error because there's a comma at the end. But other than that, it would not change anything as long as we don't have a row context around here, because there is no row context. So this would be the very same with calculate or without calculate. But calculate is capable of doing more. We can put a filter as a second parameter to it. So the first parameter is an expression, and then we can have as many parameters as we want, and all those other parameters from the second one on are filters. So we can write a filter here, and this filter states that I only want to see product descriptions which are A. So I have this table here, products, and I see my four products. I have different sales amount for those products, and there's no sales amount here. And calculate sales amount, make sure that the filter for this measure, for the sake of this calculation for sales amount, is always set to A. So I end up with the column product A, where I always see the sales amount of product A. Like it is, it's not very useful, but of course what we could do here, then we could like calculate percentages. So how much makes B in percentage of A, or how many times is C of A? This can be calculated by having this intermediate calculation and then calculating the percentage or the factors. And this filter is not only valid when we are on the product, on different products, but this filter applies also for the total, as we can see. And this again, this can be confusing for some people because people tend to see those numbers and then to sum it up implicitly and expect that at the very end, we have 4 times 30, so they would expect 120. But this is not how DAX and Power BI is calculating stuff. It's calculating like a separate calculation for this row. And on this row, there's no product, but we're asking for set the product description to A. So what we get is 30, because this is the sales amount of product A. So Calculate can also filter an expression. It does not only transition the row context into filter context, but it can also change the filter context. We could do the very same calculation. Calculate sales amount product description A equals to A, and we could add filter as a function. So filter is a table function, but it can be used also as a filter, of course, in the calculate as a second parameter. So what I'm stating here is that I want to filter on product description A for all product descriptions. So I don't care if there's already a filter on the product description table, like here. Here would be a filter on the product A. Of course, I end up with 30. But here the filter would be on B. And they all make sure that this filter is applied not on all available products. This would only be B. But all, so it's like deleting, it's removing any filter on the product description. So theoretically, this filter is put on all available products, and then it sets the product description on A, so we end up again with 30. So what we see here, this filter expression here in the calculate statement, this is again what DAX is doing for us. So if we're writing a calculation like this, calculate and put just a filter in it, what it does behind the scenes, it's expanding it to a filter all on this column, and then puts the filter on it. And we're ending up that we see only the sales amount of product A on all the rows. So filter all or having just a filter on the calculate is the same thing. It's just a syntax sugar. If you only want to have the product A, then we do not have to, we're not allowed to remove the filter. So if I remove the all on the product description, so I just state product here. So now the filter is applied on the product table, and the product table could be filtered. And in my case, it's filtered. So here it is filtered on product B, and I end up on this new calculation that I don't see anything because the filter on the product is B. I only have one row on the table B in this row. So when the calculation is done here, and the product table looks like it only has one row consisting of the product B. And then as a state, B with product, only one with the product descriptions A. And if as it is not A but B, I end up with not seeing any sales amount. So if I have different filters in my filter context and I add more filters, they are calculated like connected with AND. So B and A ends up, it's not possible. We don't have any products which have the description A and B. So we end up not seeing anything here. So this is the way how we can get the sales amount for product A only when we are at product A and all the others don't see anything. And again, this looks like it's summing up correctly, but it's not summing up. As you remember, it's calculating the same thing for the total, and here it just sets the filter on A. So on the total level, we would have the product table would look like A, B, C, and D. It consists of four values on the four rows on this total row, and we are just asking for give me only A. Without the all filter, all the filters are combined with a logical AND operator. And if we want to see all the products, we again can take the short version of the calculate. We only put all product description, then the sales amount is calculated for all the products. So we end up with a column here in this calculation, which also 670 in all the rows. Again, this might be not very useful as it is, but then we can calculate, for example, 30 divided by 670, and we see the percentage of what is the percentage sales amount compared to the total for product ABC entity. This is how we can do this, by having the all directly in the calculator. So all removes all the filters available on the table, or in this case, the column of this table. And this can be useful, but sometimes we have filters outside, and when we're not using the all, but the all selected makes sure that if there's a filter on the outside of the actual visual, I mean, this is a little bit more complicated behind the scenes, but this is how we perceive it. If there's a filter on the outside, the all selected will only show the sum for the selected products, while the all without the selected will show us the 670. And what's the correct thing? Depends on your users, on your report cases, but we are capable of doing both calculations. So we can ignore the filters on the outside, then we use all. If you want to have the filters on the outside just in place, then we use all selected for this second parameter on the calculator. All selected removes the filters only from within the visual and keeps the filters from outside of the visual, so to say. Again, takeaways: the calculate filter overrides existing filters on the same column, which ends up as a filter all of the column and then adding up other filters. So it removes first all the other filters and just sets the filter on what we are asking for. And because all removes the filter from a table or a column, and all selected removes it, but keeps the filter from existing filter from the outside of the current visual. So time to wrap up. 5 minutes to go, so I have time for some questions, if there are some. Or should we take the questions right now? Deepak, are there more questions?
Yes, no, Marcus, we don't have any further more questions on it.
Very good. Then I will wrap up it and give you back 3 or 4 minutes. So DAX is easy from the syntax side. So I think almost everybody can read formulas in DAX to understand, to get a glimpse what it is doing, but it can be rather complex because the meaning of the calls to the formulas, like there's sum x, there's calculate, they all sound the same in plain English, but they do totally different things, can be very complex, which is a good thing. At the end, we have seen that we can do rather complex calculations. We can fulfill many, many requests because the semantic is so powerful, but it can be confusing in the beginning. Then the second takeaway, don't create any calculated columns. If you need something as a column, create it in Power Query in the M language, or make sure that the data source already delivers what you need. And create instead measures for all your calculations with the correct aggregation. Hide all the original columns so nobody's confused that there's two sales amounts in the model. And always, if you're referencing the columns, please put in the table name and omit it if you are referring to measures, because we really need to distinguish between tables and columns, because in one case the row context is not transferred, in the other it is transferred, and it could be very confusing if you're not sure if you're using facing table columns or measures. With that said, thank you very much for attending this webcast. Thank you very much for watching the recording. If there are any questions, please feel free to reach out to me on Twitter via LinkedIn. My email address is also here, and I will make sure that you get the answer. I will post the slide deck and the Power BI file, the sample file I just used, on Twitter in the next hour, I would say, and also on LinkedIn. So feel free to download the thing or to contact me, so I will send it over to you. So I think I will give everybody 2 minutes back. If there are no further questions, Deepak?
No more questions on it, Mark.
No more questions.
Let me check one final time. Okay, there was a question from Anonymous, like if remove filters functions the same as all?
Remove filters? Is the remove filters function? I'm not sure. Is there? I have to look this up. Yeah. All Yeah, all removes the filters from the table or the column. I have to look it up if there's a remove filter function.
All right.
I'm not sure. I will check this out and I will make sure that I post an answer to this question on Twitter in the next hour.
All right, perfect. So we don't have any further more questions on it, Markus.
Then thank you very much. Please check out the Power BI MVP book. I'm one of the contributors. We don't earn any money there. It's going to charity. It's a book with 21 chapters, 21 different chapters. So you will have fun for 1 month reading one chapter each evening. And with that said, yeah, thank you very much. Have a nice day.